Good evening, everyone. Can you take your seats, please? I know you have things to share, everyone. Let's save those for after the event.
I just did.
Stephen Shepherd, take your seat. Thank you. My name is Johanna Wolf. Many of you have met me, some have not. I'm here in Sybil Seitzinger's stead, who is traveling and couldn't be here tonight. She normally introduces the PICS lectures. I have the pleasure tonight to introduce you to Dr. Susanne Moser. Susanne is giving a talk tonight on communicating impacts and adaptation, engaging communities when climate change comes home. Susie is director and principal researcher of Susanne Moser Research and Consulting in Santa Cruz, California, and also a social science research fellow at Stanford's University's Woods Institute for the Environment. She holds other academic positions in the U.S. as well. Susie is a nationally and internationally recognized expert in climate change communication, adaptation, and policy science interaction. And she works with researchers and governments and non-governmental institutions all across the U.S., in Europe, and in Canada. And so she brings a wealth of expertise in her subject matter. Dr. Moser is a geographer by training with a PhD from Clark in geography. And she has served on numerous international and national federal level U.S. committees on adaptation, communication, and everything to do with climate change. So I'm very pleased to be able to welcome her tonight for this lecture. Susie.
Thank you. Thank you, Johanna. This hasn't happened to me ever before, that someone introduces me with a German pronounced name. Susanne Moser. My God, that really. No, this is amazing. I haven't heard that. Thank you so much for coming. It's really a pleasure to be here and a great delight to be back at PICS. And as I just reminisced with Johanna, it's been since 1990, last time I was in Victoria. So I am just delighted to be here with you all. When we talked about what I should talk about, she said, well, why don't you talk about adaptation? And that was at a time when you weren't burning up yet. So since then, things have changed a little bit for you all, and hopefully then what I'm going to talk about tonight is actually of interest and quite relevant at the moment. But then Johanna reminded me it's not burning here, so maybe, who knows whether it has some application. We'll find out. You'll see. What I want to do is place this communication of adaptation in the context of how many people approach adaptation. Basically, the first thing they think about is, well, we assess the risks, we plan something, we do something. Oh, and by the way, last box to check, stakeholder engagement, right? It's always that last thing that we always think about, and maybe some of you in the room are in that position, either as a stakeholder, always the last one to be thought of, or the one who has to hold those kinds of things. Well, what I'm going to try to convey tonight is that what we really have to do when we communicate and engage people around climate change is that it's an enormously central and human task. It's not the last thing to check in the box. And by that, I don't mean, you know, the typical refrain of do it early and often. What I mean by that is we have to become humans interacting with humans if we want to address and communicate adaptation effectively. What that means is you have to meet people where they're at. Often that comes in the form of fears or worries, or so often in complete denial, not being interested. What? Climate change? What is that? Oh, that's in 100 years from now. So how do we tap into that? In a lot of the work that I do, I increasingly tap into people's need and desperation, if you will, for hope, because they experience the impacts happening now in their backyards, and they just feel like, oh my God, this is this huge thing, and I'm just this small. What can I do? And they just basically put their heads in the sand. So that's what I want to try to address here. How do we do that? When people begin to get it, or when they don't get it yet, how do we get them engaged and interested in this? And how do we pick them up? And of course, who we talk to could be any one of these audiences. I'm going to stay away from making this very audience specific, so I'm not going to speak about how do you talk to an elected official or to an outdoors person per se. But if that's an interest, I'm happy we can come back to that. But all of them, no matter what their roles are, no matter what their professional roles are first of all human. And increasingly, you might find this, I don't know if you've encountered that in your work, but increasingly I get calls from people wherever they are, in NGOs, in governments, and educators for that matter, and they just tell me, I need to know how to deal with those people's despair or those people's denial. And then we talk a little bit, and after 3 minutes they all say, well, I'm despairing. I don't know what to do. So it's something that is very deep in there for everyone, no matter what the position is. So how do we do that effectively? I want to try to frame that address this in three different segments of my conversation, all of which actually stems from not my own work per se, although I have some segments, if you're interested, we can go into toward the end, but it's a review of what we know about how to do this. How do people think about climate change impacts? You know, for every opinion poll out there basically talks about people's attitudes about whether they believe the science, whether they think it's a serious issue, whether we should do something. It's all about the mitigation side. What do we actually know about how people think about when it happens, when they see it coming, when it's experienced in their backyards? And how do they think about adaptation? Because that obviously would be a starting point of how to begin to address them and what might work with when we communicate with them. So that's the first portion. The second one will focus really on it's a very psychological segment, if you will, and that focuses on how we respond or deal with people if they don't really want to hear what you have to say, which is most of us don't want to really hear about climate change. And then that leads automatically into some of the more recent work that I'm doing on fostering hope, and how do we do that effectively? So let me just jump right into this piece that is about impacts and adaptation and what we know about that. It starts with this problem. If you look out in the literature, if you look out in how people talk about this, you will find about, I don't know, 20 words or whatever is on this slide, right? Let's be climate smart. Let's climate proof our communities. Let's become resilient. A lot of ecologists I hear talk about triage already. Some scientists are more like, well, it's climate risk management. And, you know, oh my God, where do you draw the line? How do you research this? Well, most people have this response to that. And they just want to know, well, can't we just use one word for that? Can't we just talk about adaptation? Well, why can't we do that? Well, what's interesting is, of course, you know, in the conversation, the public conversation about climate change, adaptation is the newcomer. It's been around maybe for the last 5 years or so, at least in that framework. Now, having said that, for us as scientists or policy wonks, having one word is very economical. It travels well. You can use that jargon, except that it doesn't work for most people, actually. When you ask them, what is adaptation? Well, the first response I always get is something like high school biology, you adapt or die, something of that nature. It's not particularly attractive to people, and so plus most practitioners that I work with in state, local governments, whatever, they haven't actually followed the scientific literature where we have spoken about adaptation forever, right? And we have done that even long before climate change ever came around. Then it was something that we talked about in anthropology or in human ecology, but not necessarily connected to climate change. So all that is ancient history. The climate community doesn't even barely know about that part of the literature. But be that as it may, So why can't we just teach everyone? Well, call it adaptation. Well, because people come from different disciplines, they come from different backgrounds, they talk with different audiences, and some words just don't fly. And sometimes you want to use these words in a very intentional way. So, for example, you know, in the United States, we happen to not always talk about climate change, human-driven climate change. It's better to talk about resilience or some other lovely word like that. Or risk management sounds very like we're in charge, right? And that's what we do. So in many places, it is simply because you want to evoke certain values or you want to have at least an entry into the door to use words other than adaptation to get into a conversation. So that's just what makes it extremely difficult to even research how we talk about climate adaptation, because there's just too many words out there. One place that communication researchers often go is to look at how is it played in the media, newspapers, TV, radio, how do people talk about it? Well, and there you come into some really interesting challenges. The first one is that, while I don't actually subscribe to this particular adage, all adaptation is local. That is great, right? So we can talk about that when it's a local story. If you have a project happening on the ground, a newspaper reporter might be really interested to show that. So you might think, that's great, we can see it, or you might find it in the media studies. Well, what's interesting is that unless that piece of adaptation work means somebody is shoveling some dirt or planting something or doing something, there's nothing to talk about for a reporter, right? You all building capacity or someone making a plan, whoop-de-doo. That just isn't a news story. Sorry. So that makes it really difficult. And the studies we have of media coverage and how, you know, newspapers talk about climate change, well, what do they usually study? In the US, it's how does the New York Times, the Washington Post, the LA Times, and I don't know, some other big paper cover climate change. But if climate change adaptation is local, wouldn't you have to go to Little Podunk Sentinel and little, you know, this whatever, every local community's newspaper? They're not in the studies. So you have a big disconnect between where you might find study or stories about adaptation and the papers we actually study. So we don't know. There's a complicating factor which has to do with anything that happens local. That's extreme. That might be an act of nature, possibly an act of God, but it is not global warming. Global warming is that global thing, an extreme event that might be an expression of that. It's part of the pattern of changing climate. That's a natural event. So again, you have a disconnect, and many people who might be able to speak about this, scientists, TV meteorologists, actually don't like to make that link. I don't know, I've heard stories here about, you know, what's happening right now in Alberta and whether or not scientists might be willing to link that event to global warming. Makes many of them very uncomfortable. So it's very difficult to find adaptation study. I think I made my point. Now, when we actually look at what do we know from studies around the world about how people perceive climate change impacts, what we find is this. I've looked at about 75 studies, and they range from anywhere from Nepal to Latvia to Italy to Israel to, you know, the United States to Canada, whatever. I think one of your studies was in that. Anyway, so you get the point. This is a global study, and it's just about studies that ask people, do you think climate change is happening here? Have you seen anything? Have you seen anything weird change or whatever? And so what we find here is that in those studied populations, they range anywhere from, you know, a few dozen interviews to survey studies of several hundred people, whatever, anywhere between a quarter and two-thirds of those studied populations actually are seeing changes. Now, you might say, well, maybe that's just a bias, you know, in the way we're asked. They were asked in all kinds of ways. So if there was a bias, you would think that given the different approaches people have taken, that bias might be ruled out. But so what we find is basically most people see some either gradual changes, more frequent extreme event, or some really strange events that have never happened in their locales before that makes them all feel a little eerie. That's sort of the overall thing. Interestingly, at the very same time that that is a finding, so a quarter to two-thirds of those study populations, you also find people saying, that's going to still happen in 100 years from now. That happens to someone else. So you have this very interesting dichotomy of, on the one hand, it stays psychologically distant, and on the other hand, it's actually in people's backyards. And you might say, how do those two go together? Well, it's an interesting conundrum, and there's no easy answer to that. One of them might simply be, well, if there's a quarter to two-thirds that say, yes, it's happening, there's a third to three-quarters who say it isn't, right? So that might be simply the fact here. But it might also be, and this is interesting when you look at these studies more closely, is that sometimes people can keep something at a distance and yet worry more than if it happened right in their backyard. Now you might wonder, why is that? It's actually, I think, easy to explain. When something comes, a threat comes really close in, the defenses go up like crazy, right? So if something becomes really overwhelming quickly, you might be more inclined to say, oh, I'm denying it. This is more than I can handle. So if you keep it a slightly further away and say, it's happening over there, not here yet, but over there, you might actually be able and willing to worry about it because it's not yet happening to you. So this is existentialist psychology, and it's quite interesting. The interesting parts in terms of just the different experiences people have, what you find is that where people are, how much outdoor experience people have. I want to emphasize this, actually. Most of us modern people spend most of our days inside. We don't have a lot of outdoor experience to see what's happening. There was a study done in 2000, I always like to tell this story, by the EPA, and it actually had to do with whether they should regulate outdoor air or indoor air. And they figured out that most people spend more time indoors, and therefore the emphasis had to be more on, if the goal was to protect more people, you actually had to spend more emphasis on protecting indoor air. But that came out of basically tracing where do people spend their time. Anyway, so this is, but people who fish and hunt and are out there working in the fields or whatever, they have much greater, people in agriculture, whatever, they have much greater experience with this and see the changes. Generally speaking, women are far more concerned about climate change than men. Go figure. Anyway, there's a whole bunch of other variables that explain why people vary in their perception. What's interesting to me, for any one of us who has struggled with how to engage more skeptical audiences around climate change, even people who do not think climate change is going on, much less that it's human caused, can be very concerned about stuff happening, weird stuff happening in their neck of the woods. And you can begin to have a conversation about what do we do here. So as opposed to adaptation being the thing that will stop the conversation and we have given up on mitigation, we can never talk about this again, adaptation might actually be an entry door that's far more effective than going straight to whatever emission reductions or whatever, or discussions about climate science. So keep that in mind. That's a possibility. And the things that seems to work for them is when you start that conversation with values around preparedness, better safe than sorry, stewardship, community, those sorts of things. That seems to be even the most ardent defenders of climate change is not happening. They will be willing to have a conversation about impacts and what to do about those. Now, what do we know about how people perceive those climate threats? Pretty much across the board, except for, sorry to say, a few Canadians. This is not really a joke. It's people who, live in cold climates who tend to think that bring on the climate change, we're needing some warmth here. But other than that, pretty much people perceive those changes negatively. And you might say, well, not a big surprise. Not just because the changes might be hard and whatever, but because we're human. We don't like change. We like to keep things the way we know it, right? So this isn't entirely surprising. Now, what's interesting here, I already mentioned the issue with psychological distance, and it can actually increase or decrease people's concern about climate change. What we find very much from these studies is a confirmation of our knowledge about what increases people's sense of they're at risk. If it can happen to them or their children, if it can happen now or soon, if it unfolds suddenly, an extreme event, very much more impactful than, you know, sea level rise relatively slowly. If something is human-made, people tend to have much stronger reactions to that than if it's natural. Well, that's just nature, you know? That's what nature does. If it doesn't also involve a benefit, if it's something you can imagine, if it's imposed on them, if people have a sense that, you know, that whatever, this is, comes from studies done in third world populations, and they feel like, well, these northerners have created this problem, they have a much higher sense of risk perception about the, you know, the same kind of impact that might happen somewhere else than an equivalent population in a northern country. And if they don't have control over it, then again, those are the things that make them feel more vulnerable. Now, this is important. What we are as scientists and as educators used to doing is we want to explain all this to people. We want to reach people about these things over their heads. But by the time people actually feel impacts, it is a heart and gut issue. It is not a brain issue. You can bang your head against that, but people will respond with their heads first and then manage the rest of it with their minds. We have one. We will use it. But typically, we manage then to deal with the feelings of that. Now, what we find in these studies is people have anything from a more generalized distress, and you don't know exactly where it comes from, to specific climate anxiety, a deep sense of vulnerability. There's a concept out there talked about climate grief, which very much resonates with Kubler-Ross's stages of grief and how we move through that, which includes anything from, you know, denying it all the way to eventually accepting it, with intense worry, sadness in between. A sense of overwhelm. Increasingly, studies show people have a sense of overwhelm and see, like, I don't know what to do, and give up. Anger, dismissal, denial, it's the full range, but people have particularly found these in these impacts and adaptation studies. And so I want to make sure that you really take home this particular message from what I say here tonight. And that is, if you find yourself in a situation to talk about climate change impacts, never, 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 ever talk just about those impacts or the risks that might come. Because people have two responses only to that conversation. They either do something about the risk, or they will do something about the uncomfortable feeling of having that, experiencing that risk. And when do they do the latter? When they don't know what to do about the former. If you tell people, the world is going to hell in a handbasket, in whatever way you do that, nice graphics of, you know, 6 feet of sea level rise, right? Whatever. Those kinds of studies, those kinds of depictions of how the world might end, and you don't give people something to do with their worry, well, then what do you expect? In my trainings, I have stopped teaching climate change. I teach social change. Because people need to know how can they plug into making a change. That is the thing they don't know. They will never, ever become the PhD scientists, whatever, in climate change. And do we need them to be, really? We need them to be able to do something with the information, whether that's a government official or someone in a household or your family member or whatever the case may be, right? And the only way to get to that is you help them see how they can make a change. I'll come back to that in a number of ways. Now, let me do one more thing here about what do we know about how people think about adaptation. It's actually the piece that we know least about. But what seems to be the case is that people tend to be more acceptable of adaptation if it has the following characteristics. If it's familiar, you know, if you're asking people to, I don't know, do beach nourishment. Well, we've done beach nourishment before, or we've done wetland restoration, or we've done reforestation, whatever. We know what that looks like. So that can't be all that bad, right? So if it's familiar, it's more acceptable. If people perceive that it's necessary, if you just say, we got to do this, and they don't see the link to why are we having to retreat, whatever, if, you know, the ocean is still there, then it's just much harder for people to get why they should say yes to that. It has to be proportional. This is the piece that, you know, we've said all along in talking about mitigation solutions. And for me, it was always the biggest problem was Al Gore's movie. I don't know if you remember how that went, right? He just told you this end of world kind of study, right, or story. And then after, you know, he was done with the story and you were practically walking out on this scrolling whatever at the end, right, it said, you can change a light bulb when you go home. Woo! You know, CO2 up to the ceiling and you can change a light bulb. Totally disconnected. So again, with adaptation, it's the same. If you say we need a 25-foot seawall, but the sea level rise over the next, whatever, 30 years is a foot, well, that makes no sense, right? So it needs to somehow go together, what you propose. If someone proposes an adaptation option and that proposal is consistent with what you would expect from that person, say it's a government official, you'd think big projects, big money, big infrastructure, lots of whatever is being moved, that is a government job. And if the government says so, it's more likely. If all of a sudden you asked an individual or a household, you do your own beach nourishment or your own seawall, whatever, that's like, wait, that doesn't work. You guys are supposed to do this kind of thing. Or big water projects, or whatever the case may be, right? So it needs to be consistent with what you expect everyone's role is in that. When you involve people in the adaptation process, then it becomes a lot more acceptable to people. If it is imposed by or compelled by the changes in nature as opposed to government telling you you have to do that, again, becomes much more acceptable. And if people have a choice. So you might say, you know, we gotta, in our community, we have to do something to better protect against floods. And you guys have 10 options of how to do that, you choose. It gives people a role in it, a choice in it, and it becomes much more acceptable than if you had just told them, and thou shalt do just this one thing, right? Now, having, I don't know how often you have this experience here in your midst, but it's certainly something that in my context I deal with a lot. And it is something increasingly I think we will deal with because the threats from climate change will be quite existential. And people just don't seem to get particularly nice when we're existentially threatened. We tend to deny a lot. We get pretty prickly with other people when that happens. So how do we deal with that? I've just, in a review paper for Wires Climate Change, tried to synthesize what we know from the literature around climate change denial and how to deal with that. And I've used Per Stoknes's work, a Danish psychologist and economist, who basically did a little bit of that synthesizing, but he didn't say, in my mind, enough about, so what do we do around these defenses? But he grouped it nicely in 5 layers that make a lot of sense to me, and I wonder how you think about it. The first layer of defense is that we don't even want to think about it. You know, we don't want to have our peace of mind disturbed. And that is why we keep it at a distance. News story up about climate change, flip the channel, right? Turn the page. Somebody talks about it, you walk away. It gets talked about on the dinner table, you change the conversation. That's keeping it at a distance because we don't want to get into this uncomfortable thing in one way or another. So that's the first. Now imagine we make it through that barrier. We get over that particular defense. And you let it in. You let it disturb you. What happens next? You might actually have to feel that there might be something we are about to lose or we might be deeply threatened by. And that creates in people a sense of doom. They don't want to be feeling that. They don't want to feel this potential loss. And the loss can be from climate change per se or from a particular adaptation option that you might put in front of them. So that's the second defense, that people don't want to feel the feelings that go with letting this information in. But let's again assume it has gotten through. You have let it touch you. Then what happens? In comes this thing we call cognitive dissonance. Because if you let it in, what happens to you? What might happen to us from climate change? You kind of feel compelled that you ought to do something about it. This is how we're all sort of moral agents, right? The minute you feel that there is a threat, you feel like we should do something about it. And then we don't. You don't want to feel that disconnect between, on the one hand, feeling we should act, but then we don't. So this is what we're managing here. We're trying to not feel guilty, basically. Again, imagine you have let it come in and you have decided, okay, I'm going to do something. I'm going to actually act on this. What's the next thing that happens? Well, we're getting closer and closer in. And I want you to notice this. This is not, you know, the outer layers. I'm talking about the deeper in we get with these defenses, the more we're trying to protect something that is really, really important to us. So the next thing that happens is that if I were to act on climate change while all my friends don't, we might actually risk losing our social standing, our ties, our connections, our status, our respect that we enjoy in those relationships. And we don't want to do that. And that's when we start to get really nasty. That's when we start to just outright deny that this thing is happening, when we just, you know, start to get nasty against the people who push it on us. Now, let's just imagine we stand through that, and we get through that, and we do it anyway. Well, if you actually had to act alone, you risk those relations, and you said, you know, this is so important to me, I actually think I need to act on this. But this is not consistent with who you think you are. You might be compelled to change your own sense of who you are. An identity shift. This is not what we do every day. This is not like changing a t-shirt. This is deep, deep change. This doesn't happen often, and people get very, very nasty to defend against us. We would rather stay the same for most of our lives than having to come into alignment with the things that drive us or are demanded of us and who we think we are. So I want to go into a little bit more of how do we actually trigger that in communication and what might we do to get over that. This is the paper that I just mentioned. It's just out in Wires, where I give a lot more background on what I think where the field is. But in particular, I go into the details of this particular strategy. So what do we do when we don't want to deal with something at all? This is this issue of keeping it at arm's length. We don't want to feel about it. We don't want to know about it. This is the issue avoidance. Just focusing on the here and now can make you just let the world and the future and everything go away, right? Oh, I just am so busy. I just need to pick up my kids from school. Whatever the reasons are that we put forward, this is the way we avoid thinking about longer term things like climate change. What's interesting to me is that all of us as communicators are slipping so easily into reinforcing that. Just take a look at these pictures. Oh, it's that, you know, every PowerPoint presentation you have seen probably had one of these items on it, something about the future. Great, you have just reinforced it. We don't have to think about it now. It happens a long time from now. Oh, it's about deforestation in the tropical forest. In the tropical forest, no worries. That's not us. It's the polar bears. It happens to other species. It's not us. And if you have a lot of scientific graphics in it, you have just abstracted the whole thing. You've just made it something that is so far from people's lives. No worries. We do this so often. And probably the most common thing we all do is be silent, not talk about it at all. This is, to me, one of the most interesting phenomena in our society, that we have come to some cultural norm, some cultural agreement without ever discussing it, that we shouldn't talk about it. The fact that you even hear about it at all, that's breaking a cultural norm. When you ask people how often do you talk with your friends about climate change, something like 60, 70% say maybe once a year. It's not even there. It's the biggest threat to everything we do and have, and we don't talk about it. It's amazing. So every time you feel inclined, oh, this is maybe not polite talk to talk about climate change, every time you sit at a dinner table and people don't want to talk about it, you just have helped exactly reinforce it. I make it a point now to just break the taboo. It makes people uncomfortable. You feel uncomfortable. But just try that, you know, and just know you're part of the counterculture, whatever. So what do we do? How do we counter that? Now, this goes right back to what I listed earlier, all those, you know, the characteristics that raise risk perception. Well, basically, if you do everything that's on this list here, you will get right through that psychological distancing barrier. You make it near, you make it about here and now, you make it about, you know, how it relates to people, what they value. You just make it, you just ram it right in their face. And just so you know what's going to happen, you're going to run into that second barrier. The minute you successfully get through this one, you will have to deal with the barrier that is beneath that. And so it goes on with every one of these. So I'm just going to pick out a couple of these to highlight. Sometimes, as scientists, we're really the worst of all communicators because, you know, we come with baggage of how we're perceived by other people. So if you have a particular audience that might respond much better to, I don't know, a minister, a young person, a very old person, or a person of color, or whatever the case may be, then let them do the talking, right? Because that's maybe someone that particular audience can hear it from, but they couldn't hear it from you, or they could just, you know, you are a scientist, you make everything abstract. You just, by definition, in some ways, keep things at a distance. I mean, it's our job description, right? To keep these things as objectively far from us as we possibly can. So sometimes it's easier to take someone else to give the message. Telling it in the form of stories, people just have a hard time resisting stories. So if you want it to get through, that would be a much easier way to get to it. Stories of well-being and community, how that might be threatened, or how you might, through adaptation, maintain it. So just a couple of possibilities here. We could talk about any one of these, but you get the idea. So you've successfully just transcended this particular defense, and then you run into people actually having a feeling about it. Great. And again, I want to show you these three pictures. You have them now in the news, the middle one here, every day. This is what we typically use to illustrate what climate change looks like, right? We use extreme events because just a picture of a blue sky doesn't quite do it. So we use these kinds of things, and we just have reinforced the thing that people are most afraid of and they don't want to feel. So you just have run right into that particular defense. Any time you frame climate change simply as something, we're going to lose something, and or in terms of mitigation adaptation, we have to sacrifice, we have to pay a lot of things to, you know, a lot of dollars, whatever, to defend ourselves against it. I just put up here appealing to patriotism or what is or isn't American, because that's what we use all the time. I don't know if there's such a thing here that you use about what's Canadian to do. I can't speak to that, so maybe this isn't, you know, where it fits for you. But there's some way in which, you know, being these stoic, defended ones is in some ways the thing that you would want to, that people appeal to, and it just shuts down the conversation about grief or fear, whatever, right? It's so, we don't have a culture that allows public displays of emotion in any form. I mean, at most, you do that in the movies, or, you know, you project it all onto a screen, or maybe in the form of violence, and then we get to legitimately say that's terrible. But any other form of public display of emotion is not something we make a lot of space for. So if you want to help people deal with this particular defense, making it publicly okay to have a feeling, welcoming that, allowing that, normalizing that, is a way to change the culture of communication around climate change. Talking about things in, if you know, the loss and sacrifice frame is very difficult to avoid, but you can turn it around and say, this is a crisis we can't afford to ignore, or this is some, you know, talk about what has already been lost and what we could restore. And so you've just used that loss aversion that people have and turned it into something useful for what you want to talk about. Linking things to health, improvement of quality of life works, so whatever adaptation action you might take works a lot. And health stories are particularly important in that regard. It's a topic that is just top of mind for most people, and it's something that makes it personal. So to the extent you can link it to improving people's health or maintaining people's health, you have a lot better chance of getting through to people. The Be Witness to Suffering, I want to just say, there are campaigns I've seen, programs I've seen, initiatives people have taken where they invited people who have witnessed some major change wherever they are, you know, someone in a, living through Sandy or some extreme event or the storm or the fires that you have right now, and basically have an exchange of government personnel and bring them to the people who are responsible in another location and tell them, you know, we wished we had prepared better. Oh, that works wonders. You have, first of all, a witness that, you know, brings the legitimacy of the issue, and you bring someone who is just like the audience you might want to talk to. So you catch two, basically, you know, you have two pluses in the form in which you communicate about this. So just want to put that forward. Also about focusing on positive emotions. Am I already finished? Okay. Just, I see you getting up, and I was like, oh, time is racing. Anyway, the focus on positive emotions, what I don't mean by that is that you should avoid talking about loss, fear, or grief. What I mean by that is you don't end there. You absolutely invite people or allow anyone to have whatever emotion they're having. But why not also talk about what a joyful thing it was to have a community work together on restoring whatever the piece of, you know, a conservation area, working together on a solution, overcoming a challenging issue, and the pride they had. So you basically bring in the emotions that come from working together on these issues, that all of a sudden it's not just a tragedy, it's not just a terrible thing that we don't want to experience. Now, if you've gotten through that and you get to the issue where people experience this disconnect between what they know they should be doing and what they know they are not doing, you are in the process or in the sphere of managing this knowledge action disconnect. And what do people, how does that show up? People will start to doubt the science. They will find some reason why they shouldn't, you know, that justifies their inaction, right? They will only take in the information that confirms what they already believe. And everything else is as if you had never said it, as if you had not said it. It just doesn't go through. Or they start arguing with you in public and calling you bad names. They will find arguments of why they are not doing it. I used to bring pictures, when I used to work for the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Boulder, I used to bring pictures of the parking lot of NCAR, just to make my point of what I was meaning. So National Center for Atmospheric Research, one of the most highly concentrated collection of climate scientists working on climate change. And there were lots of SUVs in the parking lot. And anytime you ask them, how can you do that? You know so much about climate change, how can you do that? Well, I live in the mountains, I cannot get up there without my SUV, you know, and whatever. I have a boat, I need, it goes endless. People will justify for a very long time why they do what they do, and we all do, right? If you ask me, how did I get here today? I flew here. I have a carbon footprint that from flying alone that is probably, I don't know, some small African country, right? So how do I justify that? Well, if I don't do it, I don't earn money. I don't have a, you know, professional life anymore. We all do this. It's very normal. I mean, I don't know how else we live, but how do you deal with that? Well, for some audiences, and I emphasize for some, because it doesn't work for everyone, but for some audiences, you might get somewhere if you say, you know, there's actually an enormous consensus in the scientific community, not just that it's happening, but that it's human caused and how serious that is. It doesn't work for some because of this form of selective hearing of the facts, but there is an enormous audience out there that doesn't even know there is such a thing. And for some people, they're basically waiting for there to be a scientific consensus, and if, you know, all right, if they all agree, then I suppose we got to do something. They might come around on that particular count. So you might put that out there. You might think about justifying action because of uncertainty as opposed to letting people get away with saying, well, we don't know, so let's not deal with it yet until we know. Right? Because uncertainty is that double-edged sword. It might get a lot worse. So not just better, it could be better or worse. And that's the reason for maybe being better safe than sorry. Making the moral case goes a lot deeper than making the economic case or making the scientific case. So to the extent, and if you yourself feel uncomfortable making that moral case because, you know, you're a scientist or you're a government person and that's not your job, then why don't not work with someone, come in with someone who is totally comfortable making the moral case. So you could have the scientific talk matched with the economic justification matched with the moral case. I used to be on a campaign with the Union of Concerned Scientists when I worked for them, and we did that, and it was enormously effective in terms of even, you know, because you just basically have given no way out. For the people who don't want to work on this, you've just given them every angle on this issue. Common sense type of actions that have this, you know, the characteristics of the adaptation, familiar, proportional, involving people, having control, whatever, that's the sort of thing that I'm talking about here. Let me see. For people in this particular category who are really seeing action as, you know, something, or it, for them the action is the hurdle, showing them how it actually can be done and really putting emphasis on the how. Not just, you know, why don't you prepare whatever, an emergency kit for your household. That seems like an obvious thing, right? But what goes in an emergency kit if I ask you? Maybe you in the room here, maybe you had this all figured out. Most people don't know what they have to have in it. How important water is, how important whatever maps are, whatever, right? So very specific, all the way down to what goes in it, where should you put it? In the back of the house or close to the door? What if it doesn't work close to the door? What do you do? You know, it's really working through the typical hurdles people have. So those are the kinds of things that need to be in there. Now, when it gets to denial and the last one, the identity, like I said, this is when it gets really, really tricky. And I want to emphasize one thing here that we've heard a lot around adaptation. Mitigation is all contentious. The science is all contentious. People don't agree. Oh, thank God, adaptation doesn't have any of that. If you have done anything like water management, forest, land resources management, coastal management, you know that whoever said that, whoever came up with that the first time, they had no clue what they're talking about. I mean, land use, private property issues, there is everything contentious about that. And you will deal with adaptation with all that legacy behind it. It is absolutely contentious. And when people don't want to do what you're suggesting needs to be done, you're going to find yourself in this place here. So how do we feed into this? Very often, and I have a really hard time with this in a social movement that is emerging around climate change, there is what I, you know, would call unnecessary polarization, pointing fingers, calling other people the bad guys. And I think we do that in adaptation just as much. Name calling, triggering fear with all the bad, the pictures that I showed you earlier. Using enemy narratives to tell, what's going on here. The minute you do that, you have just contaminated the whole communication environment. It is so much more difficult to have a dialogue, very difficult dialogue, about what we're going to do in these very challenging situations. If any of you have been tracing sort of what's been coming out of the people who do ice dynamics and sea level rise recently, and how many feet of sea level rise we might be expecting even in this century. I mean, how are we going to move all these cities out of 6 feet of sea level rise? That's not going to go away. That's not going to be roses. You don't want to be sitting across the table with people you have just all called enemies. Right? How do we do that? How do we come back to the table? That's the challenge. Now, what we know is that it's a lot harder to be nasty with each other when we sit face to face. On email, on whatever news sites, when you can read all the comments people have, they get really nasty very fast, right? The minute you have a climate story up and you get you get people coming out of the woodworks that tell you all kinds of bad things about you. It's much harder to do when you have to look someone in the eye and say just that all to their face. So when you know it's going to get contentious, when you know it's going to be more difficult, your impulse will be to go hiding and exactly not expose yourself to other people. But I would suggest do just exactly the opposite. And if you know it gets really hard, bring a facilitator who is skilled in doing that. None of us have had that training necessarily in our disciplines, in our applied professional trainings, whatever it is. So bring someone who knows how to deal with those situations. Sometimes it's easier to let someone else again do the talking. So if you know there is a business person who already gets what you need to do and you need to talk to a very conservative business community, why don't you let him or her do the talking as opposed to you? Tapping into competition, desire to be seen as better, as working together, and in particular, telling climate adaptation stories as stories of, we had challenges and we overcame them. Reconciliation stories, coming together, working together and succeeding. Those stories work a lot better than a whole bunch of technical graphs that you might put in front of people saying why you need to do X, Y, Z. So having stories from communities that have dealt with a similar problem, let them do the talking. Tell their story. Bring that into your conversation. The last one, the hardest one, is, like I said, is not exactly something that we or sort of want to do on a regular basis. But I think we end up, it's my suspicion that we're actually going to go through some very deep transformation and that changing our deepest worldviews and values will be something actually that will happen. Not necessarily voluntarily and all with open arms and joy, but maybe under the circumstances that we will find ourselves in, maybe we will be forced to do that. And how do you imagine even getting to that when someone is really attacking you and really denying the whole issue? There might be many instances when you cannot have a very constructive conversation, but if you see even an opening in it, framing the whole thing, say, as the hero's journey, which is a story of transformation, a story of a quest, of deep transformation, of overcoming challenges, stories of people committing, people like the people who are all against whatever you're doing, making commitments, being seen as valuable, compassionate, innovative members of the community. That's what focus groups have found. When people, the skeptical audiences in particular, who absolutely deny that climate change is not happening, when you ask them how do they want to be seen by their peers, by their community, they want to be known that they have done something for the community. If you can tap into that and frame whatever needs to be done in that context and tap into people's deepest desire, that might open some doors. Again, doing it together so we don't all be so overwhelmed that we all get, you know, confronted with something alone. Not coming in with the door closed already as to the what, but opening the conversation to the possibilities and in really requesting and facilitating that people are in a learning dialogue. I don't know if you know how people think about dialogue. It's not talking together. It's thinking together, right? How do you create an atmosphere for people to think together and hear each other, actually, and get to know that, oh, you're not an evil person. You're actually a real person. Again, becomes much harder once you become a human being to be hit against. Now, some of these things are what we're facing, I think, will come out of a place of overwhelm, futility, the sense of despair, and not knowing what to do in the face of this great threat. And so I want to close my talk with thinking about how do we foster hope, because I think at this point, and I'm getting more and more adamant about this, if we don't do this, we might as well be contrarians. Why? Because if you leave people going home after a talk and it's just all despairing, well, you just lost them. They're just now with their heads in the sand, right? And that's exactly where the contrarians and the deniers put them. So if you only talk about something that is overwhelming and let people go home without hope that something can be done, something meaningful can be done, then I think you just achieved the same thing. So that's why I think this is so important. And this is why we need it. Because what people will experience, and I'm just going to be right out there and say, I don't care if any scientist can pin this particular event on climate change. What I do care about is it's probably going to look a lot like this. Whenever we get the science straight, those patterns of extreme events, this is Louisiana, people holding up there. I just told it at dinner the story that Louisiana loses a football field every 24 minutes. A football field gone. That's people's homes, that's people's cemeteries, that's people's sacred land that goes. And nothing's there to stop it. How do you have hope in that circumstance? Or when you see this kind of devastation, that's 2016, El Nino plus climate change, plus ocean acidification, plus everything else that's happening in the Great Barrier Reef. How do you have hope in that moment? Well, let me say a word about why, from a sort of technical point, you know, why this matters. The first thing is that people need to feel that something can be done. They need to feel that the responses that you propose actually make a difference. And oftentimes, people have no clue that anything can be done. That's the biggest problem at all. They get climate change is happening, but they don't know what we can do together or what they can do alone. And so include in whatever talks you give, include in whatever outreach you do, include something about the solutions just so that people hear that something is possible and it's meaningful. And then they need to know, and me, my role in this, what can I do? And can I actually do this? Show me how I can link into that particular solution you have just told me actually makes a difference. Where do I start? How do I do it? And link it to the ways in which this reinforces the person they want to be. So whether or not they're the most liberal, the most conservative, link into the thing that gives people the deepest meaning. Whatever that is, you don't have to know it. Ask them, how do you want to be seen by your grandchildren? How do you want to be seen by your partner, by your neighbors, by your boss, whoever, right? So tap into that and link those actions to those deep motivations. Now, let me say a word about what I mean by hope, because just a couple days ago, I saw another study out, hope is not all a good thing. Well, what kind of hope are we talking about? Again, I'm drawing here on Stokeness because I think he actually is onto something. I've been working on a paper that reviews the body of literature, and actually, he's certainly not alone in how he thinks about varieties of hope. He distinguishes sorts of hope that have to do with the outcome is gonna be fine. The first one here is what he calls Pollyanna hope, where don't worry about it. It's going to be not so bad as you think. We're going to be fine, and we don't even have to do anything. someone's going to fix it. I don't know, maybe technology or God or nature will take a twist or whatever. Science were wrong all along. We don't have to do anything. It's going to turn out fine. I don't mean that kind of hope when I talk about the need for hope. The second one is what I would call, or he calls, heroic hope. And that is, it's going to be fine, but it's going to take a lot of work to make sure it gets to be fine, right? We have to really step up to the plate to make that so. So it's a much more active stance than the one I meant before. Now you see there's two more spots here open for other kinds of hope. This one is a form of skepticism, and that is where people are actually not at all convinced the outcome is going to be good. But you know what? We're Canadians, we're Americans, whatever we are, we can stick it through. We can live through that. Nothing is going to bring us down. Even if it's not great, we can make it. We can live with it, okay? A form of, this is where resilience often goes, comes in. This form of, you know, we're going to live through it, right? Stoic hope. And you weren't surprised to see something called active skepticism or grounded hope. And what that is I'm not at all convinced that we're going to come out fine. Not even that what I'm doing is all going to make the big difference. But I just can't live my life doing anything else. I have to work on this. There might be this much of a sliver of hope that we can succeed and actually get away with it in a good way, or that it doesn't turn out so bad. But I could not wake up tomorrow, I could not look into my grandchild's or my daughter's or whatever eyes if I just sat on the couch and did nothing. Right? So this is a form of hope that many of you have heard. David Orr, Bill McKibben, Clive Hamilton. That's the kind of, you know, voices out there that we have that have this kind of commitment regardless of outcome. That's the hope I'm talking about. So we're not here into wishful thinking. That's going to go out the window the minute something bad happens. That will not suffice. Or just to keep up the good spirits or, you know, look whatever happy American or Canadian or whatever the case may be. But what I'm talking about is that you are very well rooted in the realities of what is, and that you and whoever is with you, you are rising to the occasion of what that asks of us. It's really a question about who do we want to be as human beings. So a sign of maturity, maybe a growing up into maturity, cultural maturity, if you will, of really becoming committed to the highest ideals, the right action, regardless of the possibilities. And so I want to close this with a couple of suggestions of how you can foster this sort of thinking and hope in people. And this is the most important thing I want you to pay attention to. Whatever you will say, it doesn't matter to me. If you don't show up in this way, if you're not grounded, if you're not solid in your commitment, if you're not displaying that sort of commitment that we're talking about, you will not inspire anybody else. You will not be convincing. It's the most important message you will bring, how you show up, what you convey in your moral commitment around this issue. In my trainings, I often give this as a tip. Come as a friendly communicator when you come to talk about climate change impacts, which typically are unwelcome news. What does that mean? Think about yourself as a communicator, as a friend. How would you go, wherever you go, as a friend? You would say, hi, how are you? How's it going tonight? How are the kids? How is whatever, right? You would make a connection as a human being first. You wouldn't just come in the door and dump the entire database onto people. You wouldn't just open the door and tell them the sky is falling. You would just connect with people. That's what you do for first. You connect with your audience in whatever way you can, around whatever values you might share with them. You become this human person. And then before you say the bad news and what has to be done about it, you're actually going to say, you know, I'm coming here today and have to tell you something that is actually hard to hear. Just give them one slight hint that that you will do this. This kind of advice comes from doctors who deal with patients who have a terminal illness. They don't come in the door and just tell you, you're going to die. They don't do that, right? They connect with them. I mean, if they have any bedside skills, they will connect with the patient first on a human basis and will say, you know, I looked at your chart and I looked at the data and we did all the analysis, whatever, and it's not looking great, but I've seen some things that we can do, right? In other words, you just, in that moment, you have said, already I'm coming with bad news, but you tapped into their curiosity. They just, in that moment, they can't shut down. It's really important. Don't lose them with the bad news. So you tap into their curiosity, and here's what you do. There's 7 steps to this. So again, it comes a lot out of this, out of the medical psychology, but I've augmented this a little bit with what we know and how we know it and what we've experienced so far with climate change. The first one is actually a clear-eyed diagnosis. You have just warned them that you come with that, so now you're actually gonna say, you know, we did find whatever, cancer or whatever the case may be, right? You don't wishy-washy sort of avoid that. You have to say what it is. And then, once you have that one, you don't stop, you don't walk out the room, you don't leave people hanging with that. What needs to happen next is that you either bring to people a vision of what's possible, or you create it with them together. Now, what's achievable? When you're a terminally ill person, you can't just tell people, oh, you're going to be walking fine, because they may not, right? But they can maybe die pain-free or surrounded by their loved one, which is what most people are afraid they will do, right? What will happen, right? That they are in pain, that they will suffer, and that they're alone in that process. So you can actually create worthwhile, that's what I underline here, worthwhile visions wherever you are. A community might have to retreat. Well, you might lose your land. Yes, the land is going under the waters, but you can have a community together with your family, with your friends somewhere else. That's a worthwhile vision. Now, how do we get from our land is sinking to a community somewhere else? You have to have a path. A doctor would never just say, you know, you have cancer, you will, you know, whatever, after so many chemo, you might be coming out free and then walk out the door. They would actually say, here is how that chemo looks, right? They would explain the path of what has to happen to get there. And then, this is very important, you have to have a strategy for when things don't work out, or, importantly, when you have early successes. So, for example, if someone, you know, has to go through chemo, let me just say that, stick with that example, and the first couple are just fine, you know, they don't lose their hair, they don't, whatever, they don't have too much sickness, it's fine. Why don't we just quit here? As a doctor, you know you can't quit there, right? You have to go through the whole course of things, even though you also know it gets harder. So when you have early successes, people are willing to say, hey, that seems to do the trick. Let's just quit right here. And you can't quit, right? So you have to have a strategy for that, just as much as when something is going wrong, someone has a really bad reaction and you need to help them figure out maybe a different medicine or whatever the case may be, right? So you have to have a strategy for that. The next step in this is, what do I have to do? What's the patient's role? What's the community? What can individuals or communities or whatever the case may be, what is their role to do? And it needs to link very much into this strategy, into the pathway that you laid out. And you gotta link that, and this is the deviation from the medical psychology, you gotta link this into the deepest motivation that gets people up in the morning. If you tie it just, oh, you will save $3 if you take this action, if you tie it to these very superficial types of motivations that, you know, in social marketing and whatever often get used, very often doesn't hold when things get tough. When we hold on to the thing that we most deeply believe in, we actually can live through very hard things. I mean, people do go to wars. People do very uncomfortable things. They have sacrificed, right? If there is a way we record, but it has to be tied into a really good reason for doing that. And then you basically have to make sure people understand they don't have to do it alone. there is a role for this community, this government, the private sector, these NGOs, whatever the case may be, wherever you find yourself, everyone has a role, and we're all working toward that goal together. Because if people feel like they have to carry that burden by themselves, it's too much. You know, if there wasn't a doctor there that holds the patient through all the way through that chemo, whoa, that will be a very, very hard stretch, much harder than if people know they're supported through the struggle that they do. So that's what I want to leave you with and open it up for questions.
Thanks very much. So we have two mics in the room. I wanted to say that the lecture is being recorded, so your questions will go on record, just so that's clear.
Well,
so
that just put a damper on it.
Two mics in the room. Just letting you know. What was that about frankness and
yeah.
openness?
And, tell the truth.
Anyway.
Well, it's also just helping people who have questions or who are listening online that they can actually hear you. If you just sat in your pews, they wouldn't know it.
I have a statement, and I come as a friendly communicator.
Oh, wonderful.
I think people have a difficulty in thinking what they can do for climate change. It's something over there. You know, if I don't use my car, it's not going to help. However, they can have an identity with preparing for a natural disaster if they live in that area. I come as an emergency coordinator. And it's taken a long time to get people to come on board. You've come at a very timely time. This is May. It's emergency month in the province of British Columbia. And I think that if they can prepare, you know, I'm looking at the fires in Fort McMurray. If they had time, not had time, they didn't have time, but if they were told how to prepare in case when they need to evacuate, we preach that all the time, be prepared, have your grab and go bag. It may not happen to you, but it could happen in a second. Our major disaster or preparedness for in this area is for earthquakes. You come from California, you're well aware of that.
Yep.
And I think that while we sort of know that it could be caused by climate change, maybe in another part of the world, you know, it could affect us here. And I think as natural disasters, people have a closer connection to it and can kind of work with that.
Yeah. I think it's a wonderful suggestion. And I just want to add one to what you just said. You know, if you had a group like this in the room and you asked them about preparedness or helped them with what they could do, what if you asked people in that pre-emergency, whatever, there's a term for that, right? Mm-hmm. I forget, I'm sure you can tell me what that phase is when you mm-hmm. have sort of are put on notice, just, you know, a couple of days before maybe the fire comes closer. Mm-hmm. And anyway, if you asked people, if you had gotten the notice that you need to be ready to leave within 24 hours, what would you pack? It couldn't open a conversation about a lifetime of memories, a lifetime of what's important to people and why. It anchors the conversation about what ought to be in that, you know, in that emergency kit to a very deep issue around their who they are and want to be. What matters after the fire is over? What do you want to start your life over with?
There was one gentleman that he was saying he was looking for a box that had his mother's ashes in. That was the only thing he wanted to find.
Ashes in the ashes, yeah.
But, you know, I've been thinking about that, and I thought, well, what would you tell people to do that live? We've had it in Slave Lake a couple of years ago, and they don't know yet if it was an act of God. Could have been a strike of lightning, but I think when people live in that, the message has to go into their brain that just in case it happens here, what do I want to take? Yeah. Get a big metal box, get a Tupperware box or something, and put those things in that so when the message comes, you've got to get out, go.
Yeah.
It's all there ready. In emergency, we call it grab-and-go bags.
Yeah.
And they list this long of what you put in grab-and-go bags, and I think it can... prevent a lot of grief.
Yep.
Of the I should have, I could have, or whatever.
Yeah, absolutely. So wonderful suggestion. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you very much for your talk. It was really interesting, and I'm trying to mentally apply it to other issues that I'm interested and concerned about. I have kind of two questions, and they're somewhat related. The first is, I found it curious that you said at the beginning you weren't going to be specific as to the audience of communication, but in default, we seem to be ending up talking mostly about an audience of an individual that is a citizen. And I'm trying to put what you're saying in the context of, let's say, going and talking to the World, Business Council or some other really powerful and influential group, and how you, the kinds of examples that you might give if that were, in fact, your audience. Just as a different way of thinking about it. And the other thing that I wonder is, how does it work when you aren't going in as an expert with the answers, where we actually don't know what we want people to do or what is to be done in the face of a really complicated problem?
Great questions. So let me address the first one, and I'll just pick the business community. I have never spoken to the World Business Council, whatever, and I probably never will, but who knows? So of course I would pick examples of something that matters in their decision-making realm, right? And something they actually have control over. In part of my work, Johanna mentioned this earlier, I do work on communication, but also on adaptation per se and on the science policy interaction. And around adaptation, I've recently worked with a colleague on a paper about societal teleconnections. What we mean by that is that, in typical climate impact studies, we want to get the downscale data all the way to the little toe right here in our neighborhood, right? And we want to then plan for what happens in our jurisdiction. That's what most people do. Well, in 2011, there were some floods that happened all the way over here in Thailand. And yes, it killed a few people and it put a bunch of buildings underwater. Happens to be the buildings in which all the computer chips were made for cameras, for a computer, whatever. A little bit later, it cost $45 billion in global challenges. Now that's something that's starting to be a kind of sum that matters to business people. when all of a sudden car production, camera production, computer production in Silicon Valley goes out because someone in Thailand didn't do their job adapting or preparing for climate change, doing emergency preparedness, it matters all of a sudden in Silicon Valley and wherever else in the world. So I think there are ways in which, in a globalized world, we can show people the interconnections that matter that we do not look at when we think here in our little jurisdiction about climate change. Because our people connect, our health is connected, our food is connected, everything, right? Information, where does the energy come from? In California, we're actually quite interested in what you guys are doing here with your water and reservoirs because some of the hydropower comes all the way down to us. Right? So you better do something about that because we need it when the time comes. Anyway, so the point is you get the idea of we're all interconnected and we can bank on that and draw on that depending on the audience. Now, the second example of what do we do when we don't know what the solutions are, good point. I think we should all assume that. I don't know how to, I've been working in coastal adaptation for the better part of 25 years, and I can tell you I have no clue what we're going to do when the little bit of federal money that we have, and we get 3 feet of sea level rise, is going to go to New York and LA and Boston, I don't know, maybe San Francisco gets a little bit too, and the rest of us, all the other little towns, is there any money left for them? We have no clue how to do that. And they know that, by the way. Focus group work that I've done with communities, shorefront homeowners in little communities, they know that the federal money is not going to come down to them when we get that type of sea level rise. When Miami is going to go underwater entirely, there's nothing going to be there for Santa Cruz where I live or for Monterey or for any of these other little towns, right? So basically, we should assume that we don't know how to solve such big problems and that we can actually invite people around. Let's have a creative charade of, just a competition. I mean, this is what the MIT collab, Climate Collab, is doing, inviting people to come up with creative ideas that, you know, the rest of us who are so stuck in our, like, ways of how it goes would never come up with. And they have young people lined up, you know, out the hall with ideas of how to do these things. Well, maybe 90, you know, out of 100 don't work, but maybe those 10 might be really important. So this is, to me, an opportunity to say, you know, we're committed to making something happen. We're committed to finding a solution. Let's just open up the box of what that is. Let's all put our expert hats, our knowing hats, to the side and think outside the box. I think it's a way to open a conversation.
Thanks, Susie. Really interesting talk. I just had a question. In terms of, can you give any examples that really have caught your attention, whether it's things you've worked in or seen, where a communications outreach effort has been made using the techniques you've talked about and has been really successful, and particularly in reaching beyond the converted? Like, everyone in this room is very interested in climate change, but mm-hmm. are there actually some, you know, real life examples where this stuff's been applied and has been really, really successful at a local level?
That's another great question. So, for example, the stuff that I just showed you on hope, there is no study yet out there that I know of that has gone through, you know, the whole nine yards, every step in that sequence, and tried it out and whatever, measured it before and after, and, you know, any of that stuff. I don't know. But I know of many different campaigns that have worked on different elements of this. So I also have one of them on here because I'm involved in it. But we can see if you want to hear about it. But basically, it's about overcoming this first challenge with the psychological distance, you know, where people just keep this thing at arm's length. Can you actually bring it home to people and engage people in action from that? So if you want to hear about it, I'm happy to show you a couple slides about it. But yes, we have used, and here's the expert on visualization, we have used visualization in situ, which is the first time that actually has been done. You know, we use visualization, I've used visualization right in this presentation, but people have used visualizations in labs, on whatever, tables, whatever, where people get to draw. But what if you could do it right in the landscape in which the impact is supposed to happen? So you walk by, this is a bike path, this is a, you know, whatever, where people live, and there's this little gadget, let me just show you what it looks like, a little gadget like this, and people look through it, and when they look through it, they see climate change. This is the dry condition that they see. And this is what they already know. King tides, right? This is the stuff that already happens. They're familiar with. After that comes a 3-foot sea level rise. And it puts basically all those cars that you see in the background, puts it underwater. But we don't stop there. We don't just show them the risks. Then we show them what one could do about it, right? Just, are you interested in that? And we show them these two options. One is a seawall of this height, and you imagine you stand there in the landscape, and in front of your eyes, in live, you know, size, appears this seawall that has to be this high in order to protect you from 3 feet of sea level rise. So what has just happened is that you have disconnected the landscape, the ocean side, from the land side by a huge wall. And people get asked, do you like this? Do you want to know more about it? And then they get shown this other one, which is the ecoberm, form of green infrastructure or horizontal levee, whatever you want to call it. And basically, it is a multi-use thing. People bike on it, walk on it. You know, there's people in the visualization. And they get a sense of what else one can do. And there's still a connectivity between the ocean side, if you will, and the landscape. And what we've done in this study is we actually, between every one of these scenarios, we ask people, how concerned are you about current levels of flooding? How concerned are you about the sea level rise flooding? How much interest do you have in this? And what we have found is this list of findings, which actually I think is absolutely fascinating. One is that it absolutely overcomes psychological distance. And how do we know this? Well, we've done observations, not just, you know, people actually clicking on the little survey that's in this. We have done observations of people using it. And the number one thing people say when they come to this and look through it, whoa, it works. It just has gotten through all their defenses. Then we basically, you know, check about the change in concern. And what we see is that the people who come in with the lowest level of concern about current levels, you show them sea level rise, and it shoots through the roof. On average, two layers, there's four levels of concern. On average, they rise two levels in their concern. And they have, they're immediately motivated to learn more about it, and they're immediately interested in taking action. What's interesting is those who had the greatest change in level of concern are the most motivated to take an active role. Not just, oh yeah, well, then why don't you send me a pamphlet at home and I'll read up on it. No, they want to come to a meeting. They want to be engaged in conversation. And the most previously unconcerned people who have risen the most want to take an active role in their communities. They're the ones who want to stand up in front of people and give talks to their neighbors. So an interesting example, we're using this now, this was in Marin County, we want to use this in San Mateo and San Francisco and link it even more effectively with action so that they can do something right then and there. In this case, there was a bit of a disconnect between, you know, what they could actually do and when they could take that active role. But it's a good example of at least one, you know, where one of those five defenses has been overcome. So we had people show up at dialogues, a community dialogue afterwards. What was interesting is it was election season, and one person who was up for election led the community dialogue, and her opponent showed up. And when he saw that we talked with each other, that we were in conversation and it wasn't like mudslinging, he just walked away. He didn't want to talk. He didn't want to be part of it, right? So in other words, it created a congenial dialogic environment where people really worked through it, and it was full of emotion. People told stories about how despairing they are about it, how ready they are to act. So, you know, you could just see, and it was the first time more than 25 people had shown up in Marin for anything related to sea level rise. We had more than 100. So, you know, I mean, I don't think the visualization alone managed that. We did a lot of outreach to get people there, but there were about 70% of the people in the room actually had heard about the owls. So, you know, that's about the difference between the 25 who showed up before and the ones we had in the room. Anyway, just to give you a couple of examples. So pieces have been done. I don't think anybody has gone through the whole list and, you know, marched it off. So.
Actually, just following up from that example, have you identified any of the direct action? Like, if you're going to close the distance between that engagement and visualization and doing direct action, I'd be curious to hear more about those actions. That's not the question I came up to ask, though.
and I'm not the engagement person who is doing that, but it has to do with. So we want to do actually two different things. One is to have actions right at the owl where people can send tweets or express something, you know, through clicking on something that sends a message to the elected officials. Mm-hmm. So it's a form of actually immediately telling them, hey, I want you guys to do this or that or whatever. And we will have specific focus group events connected with owl visits where we then want to identify what different people would be willing to do and then develop an outreach campaign that specifically responds to that and lets different people take different tasks on, you know, as they are willing and helping them to achieve that. So again, it goes to enabling people to do that and empowering them to do that after having had the experience. Anyway, go ahead.
Cool. Okay. Early on in your talk, you mentioned about the opportunity to use adaptation and adaptation conversations to motivate mitigation or sort of an enabler, sort of a positive way of framing mitigation. I was wondering if you could talk more about that or if you have any good examples. And I'd just be curious to hear more about that connection or how you would suggest framing that connection. connection?
Yeah. So there's a couple of different things. So one thing I said was that, you know, people who are not willing to talk about mitigation would at least be willing to talk to you about, you know, adaptation. So don't assume just because they might be contrarians on one thing, you can't even have a conversation about the other. So that was one piece. But the second is, and this comes from two sources. One is that several studies have been done that actually investigated whether or not people who hear adaptation become sort of despondent about mitigation. You know, do they really think, oh my God, we apparently have given up on mitigation. Now, you know, is that really true? Because that was a lot of people's worry, that we couldn't talk about adaptation because it would undermine our ability to do mitigation. And every single one of them found this not true. But it persists as a myth out there that you can't have that. In my own work, in the focus groups I mentioned with shorefront homeowners in Monterey, what I found is that people made it very clear why they are willing to have that conversation. And that is, the minute you go down and think about what does adaptation for us look like under these kinds of whatever scenarios at the time, it was not even as bad as it is right now, science-wise. But basically, when you get down into those discussions, people will very soon realize how difficult and complex and challenging adaptation actually is. And then they say, you know, why would we bother to go through all that trouble if we never turned off the tap? why go through all that if we let the problem continue to get worse and worse and worse? Mm-hmm. So that to them made no sense. And that's when they started to say, well, can we talk about mitigation? And all of a sudden you were in that conversation. And so that's, in my experience, where it, every time I've had that conversation, where it goes. I'm not leading people there. They just go by themselves. So that's my experience. Dash for it. You go.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you very much for your talk. And I just would like one of you, like, hear your input about one of the communication things that I've heard, especially last December, a lot. And it was all around the climate conference in Paris. So a lot of advocates for climate change were using the fact that we're facing the greatest challenge of humankind of all time. But instead of seeing it as a bad way, turning it around by saying almost like we're so lucky because we're going to write history, our generation has the chance to tackle that kind of thing. And I don't really like this way of communicating because I think it does put a lot of pressure on my generation in a sense. And I just would like to hear your input and what you think about this.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, you know. I mean, what's positive about, in my mind, about the reframe is that you have actually tapped into a very deep motivation, right? We could write history. We could be part of a humongous change to the better, or at least preventing disaster, right? So we can be part of something that is very, very big, is for many people far more motivational than just, you know, it's going to save them a few bucks at the pump or whatever the case may be. So in that way, I think it's interesting. What I absolutely hear you about and is absolutely justified is that we have handed the next generation a problem I wouldn't want to be handed if I was your age or even younger. I mean, it's just unconscionable what we are allowing to keep going. And, you know, by when I say we, I want to be very clear that I see there is a very important political economy here to the interests that do perpetuate that and that perpetuate, you know, the way we talk about or don't talk about it. And that it just, you know, they don't need to do a lot to basically make all our human impulses, all the five layers of denial that I mentioned to you, just work wonders for them, right? So in that way, I think, I mean, we're not, as the older generation, we're not standing up to and facing, you know, the disaster we have handed you. So I think it's important, you know, whenever that happens, for the younger generation to say, great, we're going to have to deal with that. Thank you very much. We will. And thank you. What will you do to come along? So this is the, here's my role. What is your role? That's where that, right? If you are left alone with it, without any help, well, then everybody should get out of the way and let you do it. We'd be done with it by now. But you know what I'm saying? I mean, this is the issue where we need what's my role and what's your role to make this a feasible path. And so that's what I would say, tell them back, you know. I'm happy to work on it, and you.
I just wanted to ask about the bit where I said to, you know, never talk about risks unless you also talk about opportunities and or solutions. And so does that need to be sort of specific adaptation solutions, or would just merely, you know, talking about adaptation strategies or the idea of coming together and creating a community adaptation plan, is just, you know, educating people about that in itself a solution?
That's an interesting one, you know. So there is an interesting finding in the behavioral literature, and that is sometimes when people learn about something, whatever it is, whether they learn just about the problem or learn about the solution, they think they have done something. Mm-hmm. That's a place you don't want to lose them, not in that moment. So I think educating people that solution exists, what they could do themselves, how what they do and what others do actually could add up to something reasonable, I think that's probably the best strategy. And you know, I know a lot of people are really worried about not sounding like they're an advocate because it makes them really uncomfortable, or they're in their job simply not allowed to do that. So if that's the case, again, for me, there's two strategies. Either you simply talk about where people can find out more if they're interested, right? You have not advocated for anything, but you've given them very concrete help as to where they can go. Or you give your talk, you even educate about solutions, and then you hand it over to some colleague who is absolutely willing to talk advocacy and whatever. Let someone else do that piece of the talking. So that would be my suggested way to get around it. But it's a really tricky one of how to not lose people in that moment when they just think, oh, I've gone to that talk tonight, now I know. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, I'm done. It's as if that itself reduces the worry a little bit. So put something in there, a little something to get them up and off the couch.
Yeah, you don't want to be Gore's light bulb, I guess.
Yes.
Thank you.
Stephen.
Thanks, Susie, for, as expected, a very stimulating and inspiring talk. Lots of resonant points there. I just wanted to connect something you said right at the beginning and something you said towards the end here. At the beginning, I think you said that engagement of people on climate change is sort of the last thing on everyone's list. Mm-hmm. And we have some classic examples right here, right now, in this province and in the national. You know, there's lots happening, lots of great things happening, but it's always the last thing, if it makes it onto the list. Mm-hmm. And so, for example, the Trudeau government has set up these commissions, working groups, and they've invited the provinces and lots of stakeholders. And there's no major component about involving the public. There is, I think, a working group, someone here can probably correct me on this, but it's a very small part of the mitigation program, and it's like the last thing. In the Vancouver Declaration, they actually talk about mobilizing the public. They actually use the word, and they talk about online tools for youth and things like this. But it's tiny, and there's no working group that really is allocated to actually doing that. So my question really is, are these arguments or your you know approaches here being recognized in governmental strategies? You know, not that it's all up to government by any means. I mean, I take all these points, but you know, the fact that we're not alone, that there's all these things that you can do. Are you seeing that being picked up elsewhere in a sort of a major way, being taken on?
No, but I am thinking a lot about it and what to do about that. As you know, I work with Kara Pike of Climate Access, and we just recently wrote a paper on this increasingly recognized need that we have to make this front and center, that climate change communication engagement is not the last thing, but should be in the first thing, in the middle thing, and the last thing, you know, and repeatedly ongoing. And the fact that there is no budget, there is no training, there is just, you know, barely any capacity at the local level, unless someone is just gifted, you know, out of whatever, whoever they are as individuals, there is barely anything formal or anchored that would give you any confidence that people will be ready to deal with the climate change adaptation challenges I've been alluding to. So there's a couple of things that I'm doing right now with her. One is to ask people in those local government or state agencies to ask to basically tell us what is it that you need in terms of, you know, training and building up that capacity at the local level. What would get you to do it, actually, even if you didn't have a budget? Because people will have to. And increasingly, what I'm beginning to understand is that people actually are afraid to do it. It's probably, besides the money and the, you know, that it's just a checkbox, whatever, it's to not be out there when they're, you know, yelled at by some angry stakeholder, or that they might say something that, ooh, someone is going to use against them in a litigation. Those things are huge, and they're much harder to overcome. So part of what we're trying to do is to develop a program, a training program that trains more people, so that it's not just the two of us trying to do it, but to basically, you know, get this into the professional trainings of, you know, anywhere. I mean, we're going to target it first, basically, to coastal communities, because we got to start somewhere, and coastal communities where most of us live. So we're thinking we might get, you know, the most bang for the buck. But essentially, building up the capacity and lowering that hurdle, at least on the, you know, I don't want to be yelled at and I don't know what to do when the contrarians come and when whatever. I mean, it's really nasty in the U.S. Maybe it's not as nasty here, but it's really bad there. And also, how do we get more than 25 people in the room, the typical 25, who always show up and you already know their first names and you know exactly what they're going to say, right?
It seems to me that talks like this just remind us that there are a lot of solutions out there. There are ways to make this work. There's been some great research done here at PICS and other places, and Cara's work and many other people's work. There's a lot there, and it's used because there are proven ways of doing it. There are some successful, maybe not proven, but certainly successful stories worth repeating.
Yeah, so I think that we need more institutions that actually can provide those kinds of trainings and engagement services, you know, or be the facilitators of difficult dialogue. So part of this 2016 review paper that I just mentioned in Wires calls for that, because I just think, you know, there's too few of us out there doing this work. And there is all that great research on communication and engagement happening, and it stays within the sciences. It is not translating necessarily to the practitioner community. And I, you know, we're not actually preaching or walking our own talk, right? We're not making that connection. So we probably need boundary organizations that help make the transition and translation between the communication and engagement experts in, you know, on both sides. Actually, I don't think we have it all figured out in academia at all. But to get them to talk and exchange and learn faster and build up that community and provide those services all around the world where it is, you know. And the challenges will be different if you're dealing with people who think everything happening out there in the world is because of whatever angry gods or whatever we've done, you know, as it is often in developing countries in Asia and Africa, Latin America, or here where it's like, no, it's not happening, period. So you need, you know, skills for wherever we are around the world for these different circumstances, and build that up as fast as we can. Yes.
Hi. Yeah, thanks for coming up and giving this talk. I'm just wondering, do you have any examples, or there are some countries that have made some progress. I'm thinking of Scandinavian countries, Northern Europe in general. None of the Anglosphere. And I'm just wondering, what you've given us here is a very Eurocentric sort of approach of a society that's a dominant consumer society that's obsessed with individualism and property. I don't know how you get around that. I think, you know, you're using your approaches, you know, are targeting that, try to break that down, and that's very commendable. I'm wondering if you've looked at comparisons in other places that have societies that appear to be somewhat more cooperative than ours, where they're willing to take actions in public decisions, even getting the companies and whatnot on board to make decisions to nationally actually reduce emissions and prepare for some sorts of adaptation?
There are some out there, and I actually, let me ask you one quick clarification. When you say there are places or countries that have made progress on, in what exactly?
Progress in their decline in their CO2 emissions, in particular greenhouse gas emissions, and building in infrastructure, moving people away from our obsession. I don't know if you've noted or not, but in the pictures from Fort Mac, probably 85 to 90% of the vehicles trying to get out are half and three-quarter ton trucks. 70% of all new vehicles sold in Alberta are trucks. Mm-hmm. Even in BC, we're over 50%, 55%. And that by trucks, I'm including SUVs.
Yeah.
In vans, in the general categorization. The only year BC sold more cars than trucks in the last decade was in 2008 or 2009, just after the economic crash, and when we introduced the carbon tax, even though it was only 2 cents a liter, a message was sent there, but people for the first time actually bought more cars than trucks. Mm-hmm. And that's the only year that we've had that happen.
Yeah.
Even with all the publicity and everything that we've had here. I think it is Norway? Norway or
Denmark,
or is it Denmark that is looking to have 70% of the vehicles electric vehicles by the year 2025 or something like that? I mean, they're actually making progress right now. They have the number of electric vehicles on the road is, I don't know what magnitude, 6-10 times other nations, even the closest nation to them. Now, that doesn't make sense if they're burning coal to generate the electricity, but I don't believe they are with their massive wind farms and that they've put in.
Yeah.
And on a positive note, just on energy generation, I just saw something yesterday or the day before that, and this is in Saudi Arabia, and there's another one, I think, in Spain, of big solar contracts for building solar farms. And their rate of electricity that they're negotiating this on is 3.8 cents per megawatt. And here in BC, like our site C is about 9 or 10 cents per megawatt hour. So,
well, so you mentioned a number of things. Some of them, you know, for example, the last bits that you talked about, and I think this goes beyond sort of individual contracts that might be established between companies and governments. In many parts of the world, solar, wind are becoming competitive based on the market prices. So the dynamics there as to the adoption of the better choices for energy are, it's a different dynamic than if it is, say, between, you know, a general culture or the politics or the sort of acceptance of, you know, what role should government have. In the U.S., particularly, governments are, you know, shunned as actors often, increasingly so, because of the individualism that you talked about. Whereas in Europe, many European countries, it's absolutely expected that government take on a role as big as, you know, in dealing with something as big as climate change. So there's definitely differences in that. You can see it even in small scale studies, for example, tribal communities and how they come to agreement as to, say, relocation or something like that. Very different dynamic in how they debate those things, how they talk about these, compared to some, you know, more individualistic suburbanite sort of community, you know, Western typical society. So values play a huge role, and I'm going to point to you in a minute here to fill in the rest of that, because she's been writing about that in her work. Values play a huge role in shaping the context of what's acceptable, possible, you know, even viewed as absolutely necessary or not. And often we don't pay attention enough to those dimensions We think it's just all about particular policy or particular, you know, economic measure or something, or a technology, and we reduce the conversation to that. But I think these deeper conversations, especially with adaptation, I think the more complicated they get, the softer the things that work. So, you know, there might be instances, yes, where you need to change the size of the culvert, or you need to, whatever, do something with the water reservoir. But when it gets really tricky, well, you need to look at the laws that govern who gets the water, right? You need to look at the values that are behind the consumption. So the more complicated and the deeper the solutions, I think Donella Meadows said that best in her paper on 12 leverage points to change a system. If you really want to change a system, you change the worldviews and the values. It's the only thing that ever fundamentally changes the system. Everything else is just a matter of delay before you get into real trouble. So, I couldn't agree more with you. There are a few examples that show these differences. I come back to one example in the communications arena where many, many people in Europe will have come to the conclusion that we need two-way conversation a lot sooner than people here in the North American context. Well, it's just not as acceptable here to have dialogue and what that actually means. So here we're much more willing to listen, like you all do apparently, to someone standing up front, right? But in Europe, it's far more likely you would have a deliberative dialogue than it is here.
But look, within a dialogue, how successful birds
are. Yeah.
No one expected anything closer to that. And most of what he talks about are things that are usually not common.
Yeah, absolutely.
So some people are listening. It's still maybe 20% or 25% of the population, but there are some elements that are.
Yeah, absolutely. There are a few good elders among us. I couldn't agree more. And by elders, I don't mean age. I mean elders in the sense of, you know, having the maturity to actually have those kinds of deep conversations about what really matters. You've been waiting patiently.
Oh, I already had a good go at the beginning, though. I'm sort of curious about when you're talking about, you know, people's deep values, and if there are situations where two different values are conflicting, and I mean, I see that at an individual level, and you referred to your own conflict, which is the travel. So, you know, traveling is greenhouse gas emissions, but it's also a way of spreading the message. So, to me, those are quite conflicting needs. But also, of course, at a bigger scale, we also have conflicts. And what happens eventually in those situations? How do they get resolved through communication?
I'm going to ask you that. How do you resolve really deeply, deeply conflicting values?
I was more interested in the society.
How do you all do that? I'm going to just put that out
to
all of you.
Maybe we don't.
Sometimes we don't, and we just keep things super well compartmentalized, and we just are one person here and another person over there. I don't know, have you ever heard of a practice of working a mandorla?
Among what?
A mandorla. Mandorla, I don't know, do I have a thing here? Here, I don't know. Mandorla is this very ancient symbol of mandorla. Very ancient symbol found in every culture in medieval times. This is a typical circle. Now, I have used this in my own life, and I'll just share this practice with you because it's super effective. And it is voodoo, and I'm just going to blow my credibility with you right now here. Anyway, imagine you had two circles on the ground. And in this circle over here, you think about this particular value, whatever one that the one that you have that is completely opposite the other one. And you stand in it, you walk it, you express it, you whatever. You just are in the experience of that value in its fullness, okay? Do that for 5 minutes. And you go over in this circle. And you do the same with the completely irreconcilable other value, right? Again, live it, shout it, sing it, move it, whatever you do. And you go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And every time, actually, you deepen into it. You fully experience that value even more so. And you can do that maybe for 10 minutes, maybe for an hour. I can't tell you because you're just going to have to exhaust yourself. You have like no more new thing to add to your experience of either one of those values. And then after that, when you're totally exhausted with either this or that, you stand in the middle. And this is where the Buddha moment comes. Something strange happens. You can imagine in that moment, something will come in your intuition that is some intersection of those two things that you thought cannot live it at all in you at the same time. And I cannot predict to you. It is completely unpredictable what emerges. But something typically comes. I can't tell you. I mean, what we do in dialogue, we have these conversations until maybe we at least can both look each other in the face and say, that's where we stand. Before, we were only shouting, and the thing that emerges, that third possibility, is something new. Jung called it, the conunctio called it the third. Out of one and the other comes the third, and you cannot predict the third. But it is something different, an emergent property. Think of it if O plus H, and you know they're both gases, and something happens when the two come together, it starts dripping. You didn't see that coming, right? That's what I'm talking about. Something new emerges out of it. I've used that in my own life. It works wonders. I don't know why. I can't tell you, but it's weird. And this is what happens between people. This is what happens in conflict. That at some point, if you stay in it, if you hang in it, you come up with a whole new idea. I don't know why. Should we stop before I really lose it?
Are you okay with another question? I think
let's have one last question, and then we'll close it there.
Okay. Well, I hope this is an appropriate last question. We've talked a lot about changing people's identities and getting past the denial and changing values, but we know that just changing people's values and attitudes and self-identity doesn't necessarily lead to them doing something. How do you go to getting people to act and take action? Do you then make a specific request, or are you just sort of saying, go out there and do good, and they do it whenever they see the possibility? I've heard that maybe specificity is important. If you want to get people to change a particular behavior, you have to ask them to change that specific behavior. I was just wondering what your thoughts on that are.
Well, so first of all, I don't ever change anybody's values or identities. If anything, they will consider it and possibly change it. But I don't think that's an easy sell at all. This is not something that happens easily. In my experience with individuals, at least, I don't even know how it will work on a collective level. But with individuals, they go through a major life transformation to become someone else. So that's not, I think a challenge as big as climate change might put us collectively into the kind of situation where we have to transform so profoundly that we actually will change who we think we are as Homo sapiens sapiens, or as Western society, or whatever the case may be. So that's the first thing. That's not something we easily do. I think the way you want to communicate when you get to the values, worldview, identity issues is to make the actions consistent with who people are and link their highest way of thinking of themselves to the good actions that you might want to see. So that's the premise here. What do I do in terms of asking? When you ask people to make a public commitment We know that really well. And they say, yep, I am going to sign the official pledge. I am doing this. I'm coming back next year, and I'll show you what I've done. And if they show up and haven't done it, boy, they better have a better reason, because that gets at this piece about wanting to be respected by your peers or wanting to be seen in a community in a particular way. That's why social norms and things work so powerfully, right? Because there is a social contract we have, and if you can use it toward, you know, the right actions, whatever the right actions are, then you can get people to, you know, make these things actually. If they just go home and, you know, you don't ask anything, you don't ask for any public display, then, yeah, it's very likely they just forget it like 20 yards out of the door, right? But if they publicly said, I'm going to do this and I'm going to come back and show you, and you call on them, you follow up, much more likely. With that, thank you so much for all your patience. Great.
Yeah, now we've clapped. I just wanted to say thank you to PIX for supporting this lecture, and I wish you all a good night.
Thank you all.